الحمد لله الذي هدانا للإيمان وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير، وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله بعث بالدين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى تغرس سورة الإسراء: ومن أراد الآخرة وسعى لها سعيها وهو مؤمن فأولئك كان سعيهم مشكورا. في reflecting this ayah in سورة الإسراء, and I say this ayah teaches us the Muslims how to succeed in life and in the hereafter. It's teaching us the rules of success in anything we want to do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَمَنْ أَرَادَ, he who wants. And arada, the verb, is in the past. He's made up his mind. He knows what he wants. He's decided. So there is no changing. So it's a verb that's a past tense. The will has been decided. This person knows what he wants. Man arada al-akhira. And in this case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this person wants the hereafter. It's not just about wanting. There is a price we have to pay. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا. He has to work for it. There is a road, there is a path to achieve what you want, and you have to go down that path. It's not just لا تؤخذ الدنيا بالتمني. We don't sleep at home and say I wish and I want. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, first of all, we make up our mind and we've decided and we're not going to change because it's a past tense. And second thing, we work towards it. We know what's the path to achieve what we want to achieve, and we'll go down that path. And then the underlying fact, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ, and he believes in what he's doing, and he believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we will help him. So the success, to succeed in anything, you have to make up your mind to decide what you want. You have to know the path and work on the path and work hard to achieve it. And you have to have an underlying factor of belief, and the blessed belief is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will help you. And subhanallah, some of you might know I used to work for Rogers Communication, and when Ted Rogers used to come and visit to us, he would always come and say, that was in the late 80s, Rogers will be bigger than Bell one day. And all of us employees would smile and smirk. What's he talking about? Bell was 50 times or 100 times larger than Rogers at the time. What is he saying? But he believed in it. He believed so hard, and he tried to convey the message. So he knows what he wants. He worked hard to achieve it, and he believed. He believed in what he was doing rather than with us wishful thinking. Subhanallah. And Allah, I have a theory in life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us all what we want, but we better watch out and ask for the right things, because sometimes we ask for the wrong things. We have to know what we want, and we have to ask Allah to guide us, subhanallah. So we will always get what we want, but the problem is, do we know what the right thing is? Do we know what's good for us? And do we believe in it? And do we work towards it? And the reason I mentioned this ayah is I look at what's happening in some of the Muslim countries in the Middle East, and we apply this ayah. If we go back a few years ago and you ask the people down there, what do you want? They didn't tell us. They didn't want their leaders. They didn't want Mubarak in Egypt or Qaddafi in Libya or Saddam in Iraq or Assad in Syria. People told us what they didn't want. But they don't know what they wanted. Man arada. He knows what he wants. So since they didn't know what they want, the alternative, what was the alternative? God knows. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them what they wanted, but they didn't choose an alternative. They just said, we do not want this. And they got something else different. They got what they asked for, but God knows what did they get, subhanallah. Why? Because they did not decide what they want. They just knew what they didn't want, and left everything else for somebody else to decide. And that's one of the problems with a lot of us as Muslims. We don't know what we want. We know what we don't want, but we don't decide what we want. And we don't decide, are we willing to pay the price for what we want? Are we willing to sa'a laha sa'yaha, to work hard for what it is? Subhanallah. And this question becomes, we say we want equality. What does this mean? When I ask people, people want equality. I used to always, when I go back to Egypt, I ask somebody, you ask for equality. What happens when you get a traffic light for speeding? What goes into your mind? And the answer is always the same. I'll find a friend or a relative to wipe this traffic ticket away, so I don't pay it. We all think the same thing. How do we find a friend or a relative who could wipe it away and don't pay it? Subhanallah. We do the wrong, and rather than say, now that I did the wrong, I know it was wrong, and I will pay the fine, and I won't do it again, the thought for us is, how do I wipe it, and how do I keep going? Because equality is meant for other people. For myself, the justice and equality is not meant for me. For me, I want to get away with it. The problem is, we all want to get away with it. Each and every one of us has that same feeling. I do something wrong, and I want to get away with it, but I want to apply the change to everybody else. I want everybody else to respect the law, but not me. Should not apply to me because I'm special. And we have a nation of we all are special. We all don't want it to apply for us. I always look back home, there is somebody, people don't line up for anything. And then somebody comes late and then he tells us all, why don't you be civilized? Stand up in a line, let's all stand up in a line. And he starts straightening people in a line. And once he has the line ready, he goes and stands in the front rather than in the back where he belongs. So the only reason he wanted the line, so he can skip the line, skip the queue and go to the beginning of the line, not because he believed in it. But he lectured us all, always lecturing us about how important of discipline, how important, and yet he goes in the front of the line. If he went at the back of the line, it would be great because he's teaching us what it should be. But the only reason he's asking for discipline so he can cheat. And that's all of us, subhanAllah. If not all of us, most of us, we do the same thing and we wonder why. Why what's happening to us is happening. We ask for equality and justice, but we don't want it. We want a fair leader, but we don't. We don't want this fairness to apply to us. And you ask people, they want religion. They want religion. Then you ask, are you willing to give for other religions the same thing? And then they start retracting a little bit. What about those who say we want Islam? And when you ask, which brand of Islam do you want? Because we have divided ourselves into sects and different things, that when you ask somebody, I want Sharia, which brand of Sharia I want? Subhanallah. I might have told you the story before. I was sitting in Al-Hajj in front of Al-Kaaba and the brother sitting beside me. And the sister walking with hijab, walking across. So he asked me, what do you think of this sister? I told him, inshallah, Allah forgives her and us and accept from all of us. This brother says, forgive her? How could he? Don't you see her face? إنها زانية. She is an adulteress. A lady that's going to do to Al-Hajj and in front of Bayt of Allah, he's calling her an adulteress. That's his view. That's his view of how things are. So when we say we want to apply Sharia, is it mine or yours or his understanding? It's such a tough thing to say apply because we don't understand the basics of Islam. All of us don't understand because if we understood what Islam was about, we will not be here today. We will not be in the situation we are here, but because we misunderstand Islam and we let people who don't understand Islam teach it to us and teach it to our children, and then that's what happens. He's convinced, he says his sheikh told him she's an adulteress because she shows her face, subhanAllah. So here we have to wonder ourselves when we say we want freedom of religion, it's which kind and which religion, and even within Islam, which sect and which definition of Islam does somebody? Because we cannot accept each other. We do not tolerate. We're not tolerant with each other. And as we mentioned before, when the man came and asked what does Hina Wail means, and the Sahaba went from forever to a couple of hours, but they didn't argue among themselves. They did not divide. They agree and they respect each other. But what do we do when we disagree? We fight and we argue and say this is in the name of Allah and this is in the name of Islam. A wonderful story I read on the internet today. It says a community was building a masjid and they went to a rich man in the community to donate. And this one rich man was known not to be religious. So when he knocked on his door, the rich man opened and told him, what do you want? He put his hand out and he said, we need something for the sake of Allah. So this rich merchant spit on his hand and he said, that's what I have for you. So what does the sheikh do? He takes his hand and wipes it in his clothes and he smiles to the man and says, so you have given this to me. What are you giving to Allah? And he puts his other hand out. And the man gets shocked. You know, he has patted him and yet he smiles at him and says, thank you, this was for me. What is for Allah? So the man told him, I'll give you whatever you ask for. Why? Because this is Islam. This is the spirit of Islam, forgiveness, love, caring. As I mentioned to you, a young lady in the congregation here said, she's a new convert into Islam. She said, why are you Muslims so angry all the time? Why are we so angry? We seem to be angry all the time over nothing, and we seem to victimize ourselves all the time. We victimize ourselves. We accept ourselves to be victims rather than to understand the true spirit of Islam and apply it to ourselves. And we have to apply it and we have to understand what Islam is rather than get angry and get upset. Anger and upsetness does not get us anywhere. We have to know what we want. Man arada. We have to decide what we want. And subhanAllah, as we said, we as nations knew what we didn't want. We didn't want our leaders and we called them corrupt and whatever it was, but we never decided what do we want and what path do we take. So when our leaders changed, subhanAllah, who was the alternative? We did not choose an alternative. Somebody else chose these alternatives for us because we did not decide. We have never decided what we really wanted. And then when we choose an alternative, we choose by a whim. You ask somebody, who do you think should be our new leader? I think so and so. What is this thought built on? Why do we build that so and so should be our leader? I watched a TV show that said he was a great pious man and. Do we ask who made this TV show? Who paid for it? Who's telling us? But we just accept because a TV show told us that he's a good man. We decide. Somebody else is deciding to ask our alternative. And again, we're following. Because from the beginning, we didn't decide. And as I mentioned before, deciding the new leader is not gonna come from fresh air. SubhanAllah, I was sitting and having a cup of tea with a brother last weekend. And he said, Alhamdulillah, things are gonna get better. SubhanAllah. Why, brother, are you so optimistic? Things are getting better. He said, because it got in so bad. And we see the signs of the Day of Judgment. And he narrates to me all the signs. So I tell him, why do you think it's going to get better? He said, Al-Mahdi will come to lead us. This character that's going to come from fresh air and lead us. And are we going to unite around this character? SubhanAllah. Are we going to unite? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we said before in the Quran, tells us, وَلَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ. Allah is telling Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he spent all the money in the earth, he will not bring the heart of the believers together. But it is Allah who brings the hearts together. So why is it this person is going to come and all of a sudden we'll all see the light? And in another extreme part of this, as we know, some of the other Muslim sects tell us there is an imam who's been hiding for 1200 years and he'll come and lead us. So they made it more fictional. This person that's been living 1200 years, all of a sudden we'll all see the light and we'll all bow to this great leader. What kind of myth stories are we living? If this leader will come to lead good people. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he wants to build the nation, for 13 years he just taught them la ilaha illallah, nothing else. There was no salah, no song, nothing. And yet we think somebody's gonna come among us and we'll all see the light, subhanAllah. This person that's been hiding 1200 years, he'll come and we'll all be great. Somebody made us live a myth. and things have not gotten to the bottom yet. As I said before, things will get to the bottom, like Ashab al-Ukhdud, when they throw them in the fire, in the Mashetet bint Fir'aun, the lady who used to comb the hair of the daughter of Fir'aun, the Fir'aun threw her in the burning oil. So things hasn't gotten that bad yet. And yet the brother and a lot of us feel, Alhamdulillah, it cannot get any worse. And we sleep thinking that there is a savior coming to save us, rather than إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not change what's with people till they change themselves. But we don't want to change. As we said earlier, they tell us it's each one of us wants to change the world, but not change himself. Subhanallah, it's easier to change the whole world, but to change ourselves. We have to ask ourselves, who's this new leader? How do we choose a new leader? Did we bring up the new leader among us? And if we see the example, when the Muslim after the death of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam divided, the Al-Ansar said the Khalifa should be among them. And Al-Muhajireen said, no, Al-Khalifa should be among them. And when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq heard about all this, he rushed to his Umar ibn al-Khattab. And they started a discussion. Muslims are the same all throughout time. So what does Abu Bakr as-Siddiq do? He raises the hand of Umar and he says, I nominate Umar to be Al-Khalifa. Abu Bakr raised the hand of Umar and said, I nominate Umar to be Al-Khalifa. And here Umar raised Abu Bakr's hand. He said, I nominate Abu Bakr. And if anybody of you thinks he can lead the prayer while Abu Bakr is there, he can be our Al-Khalifa. And they all said no. So if we look at this act, it didn't matter. Abu Bakr didn't think of himself. It is just let a good man to be the Khalifa. Doesn't matter who. And that's what the ayah in the Quran that says, وَلَمَّا رَأَوْ تِجَارَةً وَلَوْ رَأَوْ تِجَارَةً أَوْ لَهْوًا انْفَضُّوا إِلَيْهَا وَإِذَا رَأَوْ تِجَارَةً أَوْ لَهْوًا انْفَضُّوا إِلَيْهَا وَتَرَكُوكَ قَائِمًا. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was giving a speech, and when they heard at dunya the caravan is out, each one started sneaking out. The Rasul is standing on the member talking, and the Muslimin starting one after another sneaking out because the good bargains are gonna go. Subhanallah, this was in Al-Madinah after the establishment of Islam. A Rasul is talking and he Muslims start sneaking one after another. And it's only 12 Muslims did listening to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And among the 12 was Abu Bakr and Uthman and Ali, the people that led the nation after. So don't expect that everybody is going to be strong-hearted. And when the dunya comes, most people will leave. They left Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They're going to leave everybody else. But the idea is those who are strong recognize each other. And here Abu Bakr raised the hand of Umar. It doesn't matter who, so long it's a good person. And that's the sacrifice. And that's where you have a group of people. It doesn't matter who's the leader, so long as it's one of them who is fair and just. And that's how you guarantee. Rather than what we have done in all our countries, it's just we don't want. Somebody else has chosen for us what they want. And again, we don't like the choice because we have not man arada. We have not decided and we cannot decide. Subhanallah. I was listening in the news before I came to the prayer, and they said that the Free Army is fighting, but not fighting in Syria, not fighting the Syrian army, they're fighting among themselves because they cannot decide among themselves. Subhanallah, we fight among ourselves because we cannot decide what's good and we cannot unite, subhanallah. But the unity is never under somebody's name. The unity is under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I always say, if you look in the Quran and Sunnah for wahda or ittihad, which is unity, you will only find one word, Allah wahid. We unite under the sign of Allah and under the religion of Allah. Anything else does not, and we cannot unite because we're human. And each one wants what's good for him, wants something else. But if we all go back to Allah and believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do things for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring our hearts together, and it doesn't matter who leads us. Subhanallah, if we choose, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will we leave the choice and we be the right people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring the right person, inshaAllah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, all the children of Adam commit mistakes, and the best of those who commit mistakes is those who ask for forgiveness. So let's pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask for his forgiveness. الحمد لله واشهد ان لا اله الا الله واشهد ان محمد رسول الله. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم تلزس حسن اسلام المرء ترك ما لا يعنيه. To be a good Muslim and to improve on your Islam, mind your own business. Subhanallah. Focus on your business. And as we said before, each one of us, everything is our business except our own business. We neglect our job, we neglect our children, we neglect our neighbors, but politics is our business. Deciding when the new month is our business. Deciding everything else is our business, except focusing on what we have to do. And each one of us realize we are an important part of the society and do his part, the whole society will raise and the whole society will improve. But we all want to be this like guy who tells everybody to discipline and have a queue, but he doesn't have discipline himself. We have to, each one of us, realize his responsibility and do the right thing and believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believe that وَمَا النَّصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. Victory is from Allah. وَكَانَ حَقًّا عَلَيْنَا نَصْرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the believers victorious. Allah, إِنَّ اللَّهُ يُدَافَ عَنْ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah will protect those who believe. So we do our part that we believe and we help each other, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inshaAllah make us victorious and help us inshaAllah. And an example we said before, there was a just king and he told his people, if you love me, I'll put on Friday a big pot and each person brings a small thing of honey, a very small cup of honey, and puts it. He said, asked them, is that fair? Everybody said, of course it's fairer. Each one of us could afford it. It's a very small thing of honey. So Friday comes, and at the end of the day, they looked in the pot, and it was all empty. Why? Because each one said, I will not make a difference. Everybody else was so anxious and so gung-ho that he will put his part, I will not make a difference. So there was only a few in the bottom, because each one thought, what is that small little thing I will gonna contribute, make a difference in this whole town? Subhanallah. So the king again came and said, if you love me, do your part. Put a small thing, you have another chance. And the next Friday when they looked, it was full of water. Why? Each one said, is my little thing gonna make a difference? I will put some water because my neighbor and his friends and everybody else is putting the honey. But that's how our story is. I do not make a difference. But we do, and we have to realize that each and every one of us has a responsibility. That small little part, if each and every one of us abdicate this responsibility, the net result is zero or negative. Subhanallah, we all have to realize we all do our part. And our part where we can. حسن إسلام المرء ترك ما لا يعنيه. If you look at us as Muslims, how much time we waste on politics and the conspiracy and talking about the bad conspiracy rather than putting our effort to build. You look at us as Muslims here in Canada. We don't have a leader. We're not united because we are divided. Each one wants to be his own leader. Subhanallah. Every masjid you ask what happened to so and so, he got upset and he started his own masjid. That's how we are as Muslims. We don't understand how to have a dialogue. We don't understand how to talk. All we do is, I will start my own. And that's how we all are. And then we wonder, why are we like this? Wonder what's happening. Subhanallah, I read an article for Sheikh Ghazali. He's saying when the Muslims were opening all of Europe, the Muslims were coming from the east through Eastern Europe and coming from the west, from Andalus into France. And the Western people decided to get a wise man to tell them what to do. The Muslims are coming from both sides of Europe and they will take all over Europe. The wise man said, I seen them in battle. These people put their heart for the sake of Allah. We can never defeat them in battle. He said, try to divide them. Don't try to fight them anymore. We have known we will lose any battle against them because their heart and they fight for the sake of Allah. But divide them, make them smaller. Come to each one of them and remind him where his origin is. He's not a Muslim anymore. He's from this tribe. He is. And he said, once we succeed in this, we will conquer them. And that's what they did. They succeeded in dividing the Muslims into small emirates in Andalus, and then they took each one by itself. Why? Because the hearts stopped being together. And that's what we have to understand. We all go back to Allah and do the things for the sake of Allah, inshallah, and Allah, inshallah, will make us victorious. And if we look, in spite of all what's happening in the Muslim world, we look what's happening in the Masjid al-Aqsa, and now, after it was all for the Muslims, the new plan is to divide the time. It becomes a time share. The Muslims will have some time, and the Jewish will have some time. Why? Because we're all busy. We're busy with ourselves. We fight among ourselves, thinking that we are right, and they're taking it away from us because we are divided. And each is only thinking for himself. And when you talk to some of the Muslims, he says, who cares? Who cares, subhanAllah? And let it all. Rather than we realize we all have a responsibility, and this is our achievement through time. Our achievement is not only we lost Jerusalem, now it's being divided in time share, subhanAllah. And then the time share, as they taught us the story with Guha, when he had a mule and somebody was hitchhiking, he took the person who hitchhiked with him on the mule. So the person told him, Guha, you have a wonderful mule. He said, thank you. 5 minutes later, the person said, Guha, I love our mule. So Guha told him, get off. He said, why? He said, 5 minutes ago, it was mine. Now it's ours. In 5 minutes, it's probably you're gonna say it's yours. We have to wake up. First it's yours, and then it's ours, and then it's mine. So we have to realize what's happening and not stay quiet. And then when we realize, one of our biggest problem is we don't understand when we don't read the Quran. You see people in demonstrations saying, let's go to the American embassy, let's go to the Russian embassy, let's seek help, and they don't read the Quran. إِسْتَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ. When you scream for help, ask from Allah. And what does the ayah say? فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. He answered you right away. But when we go to this embassy or this, we don't see an answer. They laugh at us and say, look at them coming to us. Maybe we'll act, maybe we won't. But what do we expect? The Quran didn't tell us, go to this embassy or this embassy or this parliament. It said, إِسْتَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ. When time of trouble, why don't we ask Allah? And he said, فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. The fih in Arabic in the Quran means right away. The answer came right away. فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ, he answered. But how many of us in all these demonstrations did we get an answer? And I share with you what happened with us, most of us in the year 2000, when there was a problem in Palestine and all the Muslims of Toronto went downtown, and downtown Toronto was full of Muslims. And me, like everybody else, was so proud and said, in the news today, they will tell us about this great Muslim gathering. It was over 100,000 or 200,000 downtown. When I watched the news said a few hundred or a few thousand Muslims gathered in downtown Toronto for Palestine. And in Ottawa, there are tens of people around the parliament for Israel, and they said thousands of people, a large, large crowd of people were demonstrating for Israel. Why? Because we didn't istaghis Allah. We went to the American embassy asking help, save us. So we got the answer in the news. A few Muslims gathered. Because if we istaghis Allah, فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. But when we go to any embassy and we all do and we all this and that, what we're focused, subhanAllah, get your answer. Get whatever answer you get. And that's why we have to wake up as Muslims. And when we want to seek, we seek help from Allah. إِذَا سَأَلْتُ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. If you ask, ask Allah. وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. Huh? If you need help, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're told all this, but we don't apply it. We think there is other things. Oh, inshallah, we have to listen to the ayah. وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. He who wants, and we have to know what we want. It's not know what we don't want. We all know what we don't want, but we have to know what we want. وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا. And we have to put a plan, and we have to work hard for it. Nothing is easy. وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. And we have to believe. And the best belief is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of us. And this is how it is. But if we seek help from anybody else, and we want help from anybody else, we get what we deserve. If we don't decide, somebody else will decide for us. That's how it is. We've left the choice. We said, I don't want, So we left the choice. And finally, I shared with you the example I shared with you again. I was going for dinner one day with my children, and I said, I'm a democratic person. We have a choice to go to this place or this place or this place. Kids, you decide. And they argued among themselves and then finally agreed. And I told them, this is democracy. I chose three places that I like, and I didn't care which one. It wasn't true democracy. I didn't tell you choose. I chose for you. I just didn't tell you that I like the three of them, and anything else is not acceptable. That's what happened when we don't have a choice. When we don't know what we want, somebody else chooses for us and gives us three different people with three different personalities, but they're all the same at the end of the day. Why? Because man arada, we don't know what we want. We have to learn the Quran, we have to know what we want, and we have to work to it, and we have to believe inshallah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward us all inshallah.